Welcome to the Inside View. I'm Ralph Renzulli, your host. Thank you for watching. I'm really pleased to have with me today Assemblyman Robert Smullen, who represents the 118th District. Robert retired from the Marine Corps in 2015 at the rank of colonel with 24 years of service and three combat tours in Afghanistan, including participating in Operation Enduring Freedom after the September 11th attacks. He also served at the Pentagon as a military strategist and in numerous command and staff positions around the world. In 2003, Robert was appointed by President George W. Bush as a White House Fellow serving at the United States Department of Energy in the Office of the Secretary of Energy. Before his election, Robert was the Executive Director of the Hudson River Black River Regulating District, a New York State public benefit corporation. Robert, welcome to the Inside View, and thank you very much for doing this. And more importantly, thank you for your service.
Oh, well, thank you, Ralph. Appreciate it's a pleasure to be on here. It's September 11th. It's almost incredible to believe that it's been 23 years since America was attacked on September 11th, 2001. And it's heartening to see. I was at a ceremony in Utica, another ceremony here in Herkimer County. People are still marking what happened, but also importantly, remembering what happened. You know, to remember the spirit of America after September 11th was one of unity. It was one of resolve. It was one to say that, you know, these sorts of actions cannot stand, and we, the United States of America, will do something about it. And it for me, it was something very personal that, you know, after September 11th, my unit was sent to Afghanistan.
Everybody remembers where they were. Where were you?
So I wasn't even in the United States. I was actually in Darwin, Australia. I was part of the 15th Marine Expeditionary Unit, Special Operations Capable. I was the operations officer of 1st Battalion, 1st Marines out of Camp Pendleton, one of the storied battalions, the 1st Marine Regiment, first to fight. We were on our way to the Arabian Gulf on Navy ships out of San Diego. We'd done our training workup. We had gotten together with all the units that made up the Marine Expeditionary Unit, the Amphibious Ready Group, and we had set sail from California, visited Hawaii, and we were actually in Darwin, Australia, in the northern territories of Australia, doing a big training exercise, basically to knock the, you know, the cobwebs off after having been at sea for, you know, 20 plus days, to get ready to go to do a UN humanitarian mission on the way in East Timor. And when the towers were attacked, our mission immediately changed, as you could imagine.
Mm-hmm. Let's just do a little bit of a rewind. Where were you born? Where did you grow up? Where did you go to high school?
Oh, yeah. So I was actually born right here in the Mohawk Valley in Gloversville at Nathan LaTower Hospital. I'm very proud to be from a little hamlet called Miko, which is just outside of Gloversville. Grew up in a very tight-knit community. Our family, we were masons. We did construction work. I joke that before I joined the Marine Corps at 22, you know, I'd had about a 10-year career doing masonry construction growing up. I went to Gloversville High School, graduated in 1986, and I always wanted to join the military, so I went to military college down at the Citadel in Charleston, South Carolina. That's where I took Naval ROTC, and that's how I got into the Marine Corps.
I was going to ask you about that, the Citadel. What's it like to attend a military college?
Well, it's very different than most students' college experiences. For me, it was a good experience. For, you know, someone like myself who was you know, a lot of energy, not a lot of direction in those days and years. It was a big dose of discipline, and it served well. But especially, it was a route to get into the military, because they had all branches of service there: Army, Air Force, and a Navy Marine Corps ROTC program that's second to none even today.
So, talk about discipline, Marine Corps. Did you do your basic at Parris Island?
No, we actually did officer candidate school. It's at Quantico, Virginia, which is in northern Virginia. It's where all officer training happens. Every Marine Corps officer goes through essentially the same training regime. They go through officer candidate school, and then they go to what's called the basic school. It's a six-month period of instruction where you're all trained, all Marine Corps officers, whether you're a pilot, whether you're a supply officer, whether you're an infantry officer like myself, you're all trained to be a platoon leader, to be able to keep up with the Marine Corps ethos that every Marine is a rifleman, meaning whatever the situation is, you know what to do when the time comes.
So how does officer training school differ from Parris Island?
So at Parris Island and at San Diego is the Marine Corps recruit depots. That's where all the enlisted Marines are trained. They're awesome recruit depots. They take someone in off the street of America from all walks of life. And I say that the Marine Corps is the number one institution of American unity. The military is the number one institution of national unity, clearly. But the Marine Corps takes someone, doesn't matter where you're from, as long as you qualify for the standards of the Marine Corps and can get in, they will take you and train you to be a Marine, you know, first and foremost. And they also do all sorts of technical training for all the skills that the Marine Corps requires. But though that actually happens at two places, Parris Island, South Carolina, and at San Diego, California.
Okay. You mentioned you were always interested in the military. Any particular reason why? Is this in your family history or?
You know, I think it's a family thing. My father was in the Army, but more importantly, in my extended family, the construction, masonry construction family that I was in, two of my great uncles served in World War II, and they were very influential in retrospect. One was a Battle of the Bulge veteran who at 19 years old was thrust from living in Meeko, New York to, you know, going through Army training and finding himself in December of 1944 in the Battle of the Bulge. Another was a 10th Mountain Division veteran who trained at Camp Hale, Colorado, and then was deployed with the 10th Mountain Division and saw combat for almost a straight year in the mountains of Italy, all the way up to you know, the northern part of Italy at the end of the war. And they were very deeply influential on me.
So three tours in Afghanistan. What was your role?
So the first time I was the operations officer of a battalion. When September 11th happened, we were on our way to the Gulf. Instead, we went first into Pakistan, where we did support and security operations for getting ready to go into Afghanistan. Then we actually went into Afghanistan. We went into Forward Operating Base Rhino in Kandahar province in southern Afghanistan. We did interdiction operations along Afghan Route 1, basically stopping the Taliban from being able to move in southern Afghanistan. And then we seized Kandahar Airport, or the Task Force 58, which is what it was part of. It was the main part, the main effort in southern Afghanistan in the fall of 2001.
So at that point, what was your rank at that?
I was actually a major. I was brand new major. I was the operations officer for a battalion that I'd been in at that point for 3.5 years. And, you know, my role was to direct the operations of the 1,250 Marines and sailors of that battalion landing team.
Interesting. So presidential politics, I can't help but bring this up. Afghanistan has been the topic of conversation in this campaign, and I'm curious about your opinion. They're talking about Biden's botched withdrawal from Afghanistan. You're a military strategist. Mm-hmm. You were there. How do you feel about that?
Well, I was there twice more after my initial tour in 2006, 2007. I was a combat advisor with the Afghan National Army. I went back in 2011, 2012, and worked at the International Security Assistance Force headquarters. So I saw the war over a very long time, mm-hmm. From very different perspectives. In between, I actually spent a year at War College actually studying the problem very directly. And, you know, when we left Afghanistan precipitously 3 years ago, it was due to a misreading of what was happening on the ground in Afghanistan. You know, we knew that we needed to scale back and reduce our commitment to Afghanistan, but I don't think the intent was ever to throw away all of the blood and treasure that we had spent over those 20 years. It should have been a reduced presence that was kept for a very long time to be able to, it's a very volatile, very important part of the world. You know, Afghanistan is not a country. Some people think, well, there are Afghan people. There are people that call themselves Afghans, but they're There are different tribes that live in this area that's centered around Kabul. And it's between Pakistan, it's between Iran, and it's between the stands, Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, Turkmenistan. It is not a nation in any sense. It's a crossroads that has always been contested by a variety of different groups. And our 20-year involvement there, unfortunately, never realized that it was a very, the task, the mission that we were given, you know, particularly by the surge in the Obama years, was very misguided. And it was never going to work, just like we weren't going to turn South Vietnam into the United States, you know, 50 years before. And we ended up leaving there because of a series of miscalculations and a very severe misread of the situation. And it was a total disaster. Yeah.
In terms of the military strategy, how did the topography and the terrain of Afghanistan make it a different war from traditional wars?
Well, it was a very different war in that it was very spread out. Afghanistan, it looks like on a map that it's, you know, this spot that you could, well, if you control this, you can control that. When there are tribes that are spread out all over, 25, you know, some million people there, and you're only a very small force. When I was there in 2006, 2007, there were only about 20-some thousand Americans there. When I went back in 2011, 12, you know, even 100,000 American troops is nowhere near what you would need to be able to control such a place. Mm-hmm. Even if you wanted to control such a place, it would be very difficult to do so. And when you look at the you know, the geography today, it's, you know, nothing has changed. Afghanistan is not a cohesive nation.
So you left the service in 2015, and you got into this Hudson River, Black River. But can you tell me a little bit about that? What is that?
Well, so actually I retired. So I retired from the Marine Corps, and I thought, gosh, you know, this is going to be great. I'm going to go back to I bought a farm in my hometown. I live a mile from where I grew up, actually. It's kind of neat. I love my family. I love living in upstate New York. And I had started to build a house on the farm. There was already an existing farmhouse, but I started to build this. Well, I was at the Department of Energy. I got the bug about energy efficiency. And I had this plan to build this really neat American energy house. It's super energy efficient, no more expensive than building a regular house, you know, some innovative technologies, all putting them together. About a year into that, all of a sudden this job popped up on Indeed.com that said, you know, we're looking for the leader of a environmental public benefit corporation. And I literally put my resume in and got a call. This is a governor's appointment. You know, this is a, you know, fairly coveted position, if you will, in New York State. And I interviewed, and the board hired me. I was pleasantly surprised, a little bit shocked, and I started working this organization that's job is to do flood control. So way back in the day, 100 plus years ago, Albany flooded on a routine basis. So they built these reservoirs that would regulate these rivers. And they needed a leader to be able to do all of the work involved in essentially a 10-county flood control agency. So I started doing that, and it was a great introduction to New York State.
Were there any skills that you acquired in the service that were transferable to this project?
Absolutely. Oh, certainly. You know, I'd done some programs of instruction about, you know, management and done a lot of leadership things. This was all about leadership, and it was all about getting things done from the executive chamber down to being out in the community and keeping a pulse on what people wanted around the Great Sacandaga Lake, for instance. So yeah, it required really good leadership. I did that for about 2 years.
And after that, you got into politics.
So it just, you know, it just happened that at the time, Mark Butler, who many people from Herkimer County know, was the longtime assembly person, and he decided to retire. So it was a primary race to be able to replace Mark Butler in the assembly. You know, it's once in a decade opportunity, maybe even, you know, once in a couple decade type opportunity when a job like that comes open. So we thought about it. You know, some people encouraged me to run, and we threw our hat in the ring.
But there must have been some other inspiration for you. Public service? What was it?
So actually, my dad had been the town supervisor for the town of Johnstown in Fulton County. He'd actually been chairman of the board. And, you know, when they had asked him to run, he was a business person. He was, running the family business. And it was a big, you know, and I can remember it just like it was yesterday. I must have been, 15 years old. And it was a big deal that he was going to do this, because he's public spirited, because he's, you know, deeply embedded in the community. And for me, it was the same thing, just on a different level and a different role. Yeah.
So family history influenced you militarily and politically. It's interesting.
And I'd been a White House fellow for George W. Bush. So I'd had a little bit of look into politics in the middle of my Marine Corps career. And it's very interesting.
So I wanted this to be a little bit of a civics lesson. What is the job description of an assemblyman? Tell me, what do you do?
So fundamentally, the job is to represent the people of the 118th Assembly District. Each district is about the same size in terms of people, mm-hmm. about 130 to 135,000 people. And but the difference is that all the assembly districts are different shapes. My assembly district, the one I'm very, very proud to represent, it's most of Fulton County, most of Herkimer County, all of Hamilton County, the west half of Montgomery County, four towns in Oneida County, and soon to be one town in Otsego County. It's the largest assembly district by square miles in the entire state. It's about 4,000 square miles. Wow. It's enormous. You know, it goes all the way from the lower part of the Mohawk Valley all the way to Long Lake. You know, all the way from, you know, Gloversville, Johnstown to, you know, west of Utica. Sort of thing. So it's
huge.
Enormous.
Oh, you do a lot of driving.
A lot of driving around, and because the job is to represent the people. So you ask what the job is about. It's about three things, I would say. The first, in representing the people, is to go and vote. So that we bring up in the assembly session that's from January to June of every year, we bring up about 1,000 bills a year. You've got to know what's going on. And I hadn't been in legislative leadership before, but I really know now what all the bills are about. And I read what's going on in public policy. And then you know from talking to literally thousands of people over the years how the district would want me to vote on, pick a bill, an education bill. I'm the ranking member on the Higher Education Committee. You know, I know what our communities, our community has two community colleges, Herkimer College and Fulton Montgomery Community College. What does our community need in the higher education realm? Because I'm on six committees. I'm the ranking member of the Higher Education Committee. So my job there is to look after all of the SUNY schools, all 64 State University of New York schools, all of the CUNY colleges, the City University of New York that are in New York City, and all of the public all of the private colleges that are in New York State, 100 plus. So it's an enormous job of oversight to be able to look at where we're spending our public dollars for our public universities, but then also how we support a major component of our communities, which is our private universities. That's one committee that I'm on. Another committee that's very important is the Ways and Means Committee. If you want to know what's going on in state government, follow the money. If you follow the money, you'll know where the policy is. And it's been great. I'd had some experience in doing Pentagon budgeting. Mm-hmm. I did a degree at the National Defense University, a Master of Science in National Resource Management. So I get money. I get how it works. I get how public policy is tied to it. That's been a great translation of my military training and experience to what goes on in state government. But I'm also on other committees. I'm on the Veterans Committee. I'm very glad to take care of our veterans that are, throughout New York State. I'm on the Labor Committee. I look at all of the issues that affect our workforce. I'm also on the Banks Committee. So I look at how the financial services sector plays in New York State as a whole. And, overall, having been on all of these committees, it gives me a good broad base. And I've served on a few others as well that I've been on and off. I've been on the Libraries Committee. I've been on the Social Services Committee. I've been in Economic Development. When I see all of these things, I have a really good sense of what's going on in New York State these days.
So when you're in session, Describe a typical day. What would that be like?
Yeah, so it starts early because it's always a long day from January through June, and especially around the budget time when it's the end of March, when the budget is due on April 1st. We've had a few problems of not having the budgets on time. We can talk about that.
We are going to talk about that.
But and that's politics. But it you meet with a lot of people. So the other third part of my job is to do constituent affairs work. So I have a lot of people that come down to Albany that want to meet with me, whether they're a constituent from the district or whether they are a representative of an organization, an advocacy organization that wants a particular policy passed, a bill passed, or, you know, wants me to support an initiative or, you know, whatever the case
right.
is. I start meeting with people right beginning in the morning. And then you get into committee work, which is the committee is, you know, bills are introduced. They are, you know, vetted through the committee system. We speak about them in committee. We vote on them in committee. We send them to the floor. That takes up a lot of time. A lot of that's on Tuesdays for whatever reason. That's how the system is set up. And then we have the actual session itself, which is the, you know, like you see on TV. And anybody that's listening is welcome to come down and observe it. It really is. You want to talk about a good civics lesson? You can see the people assembled in Albany from January through June. Just get in touch with my office. I'm in Legislative Office Building Room 635. You're welcome to come down. I'll have you down on the floor, introduce you. It's great, especially for teaching younger people civics lessons. I love to have school groups down. But we're in session, and they'll bring bills up, and we'll debate bills, and we'll vote on bills, and we'll talk about all of them. But those three things happen all the time: constituent affairs work, committee work, and voting on bills. And that makes up the bulk of the time in the session that's when we're in.
So our state government is similar to our federal government in the way it's structured: bicameral. You have the legislature, you have the assembly rather, and you have the Senate. Speaker of the House, President of the Senate, Governor, Executive Branch, Judicial Branch. If you wanted to introduce a bill from day one, how does that start?
It's actually a fairly simple process. You get an idea. Someone says, aha, we want a bill for, let me give you a real-world example. In upstate New York and rural areas, I'm the author of the Rural Equity Initiative for upstate New York. Medicaid doesn't pay our ambulance services enough to cover their costs. It's a one-size-fits-all program that's designed for the entire state. However, in upstate New York, in rural areas, ambulance calls are farther apart and fewer in number. So if you wanted to say that the real cost for an ambulance ride from pick a town in Herkimer County, say the Village of Newport to the hospital in Utica, it's actually more expensive than it is for someone who lives in New York City who's going from, you know, six blocks around the corner to, you know, Montefiore Hospital in New York City. I have a bill, an idea, that says we should just pay our ambulance providers the real cost of what it costs to be able to move somebody from point of injury to where they can get help, right? So I introduced a bill, and I sent it first to write down the tenets of the bill, and then I sent it to the Legislative Bill Drafting Commission after putting it through our research and our ways and means analysis people, and we find the language for the bill. And then that bill itself gets put into the legislative bill system, and then I go around and I ask people for support for the bill. I go around all my colleagues. Will you consider co-sponsoring my bill? And they either sign on to the bill or they don't. And then it gets sent to the Committee of Jurisdiction where it goes into consideration in the system, if you will. It's a very simple process.
Yeah. How big a staff do you have?
Actually, I have a very small staff. I have two direct folks. I have a chief of staff who's in Herkimer County and a constituent affairs person who is in my Johnstown satellite office. However, there are people in Albany that we have a central staff where they work for their lawyers, their legislative researchers, their money people that know all the ins and outs of the system. So when I draft a bill, for instance, it gets reviewed by some people that know what they're doing.
But if there's a bunch of research to do, you're probably doing a lot of that yourself.
I can do it, and I'm actually, yeah, it's something that you always wish there's more time in the day to be able to do all the work that needs to be done.
I think that's a good time for a break. We'll be right back after this short message.
Visit My Little Falls and stay connected with the latest news, information, and events in the city and the area. Our mission is to generate interest in the community and connect residents in a more meaningful way by facilitating deeper conversations about how these stories will shape the future of the Mohawk Valley. Join thousands of weekly visitors who stay up to date with feature stories, interviews, videos, our event calendar, and print publication, The Mohawk Valley Express. It's about timely local news for the community, keeping citizens informed about important issues, telling about the people who live and work here, and giving locally owned businesses the opportunity to reach a very targeted audience of locals and tourists alike. It's a whole new form of media-rich content developed specifically for today's mobile lifestyle and listeners. You can download our iOS app in the iTunes store, listen to our country music streaming radio station, or sign up for a weekly newsletter. Stop by today at mybuttafalls.com. You'll be glad you did.
And welcome back to the Inside View. I have Robert Smullen. Robert, you are a self-described conservative Republican working in a legislature dominated by liberal Democrats. How's that working out for you?
Well, what I say is it's working out just great because I take our voice and our values directly to Albany on behalf of the people. And they really need to know what's going on in the legislature. The assembly needs to know what's going on in the rural districts of upstate New York. And I think that I'm very effective at being able to do that because I learned a lot from my time in the Marine Corps. I can work with anyone on any different issue. It doesn't mean I agree with them. It doesn't mean that because I'm talking to someone who's from, you know, Brooklyn or the Bronx, that I'm suddenly going to, you know, adopt all of their policy positions on, you know, pick an issue sort of thing. Subway congestion pricing for New York City. What's the right way to fund the subway so people can get around New York City? But I can understand the issues because I can understand how to talk to the people. I can talk to anyone about any different issue. But what I'm careful to do is articulate what the people in this particular region, this district, want and need from their state government. And New York is a very big, very diverse state. And unfortunately, the way the demographics are, you know, there's two Democrats for every one Republican. So you don't win a lot of votes in committee. You don't win a lot of votes on the floor. But you got to make sure that the point is made, that the opinions are registered, and the vote is done the way the people in the district want it.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned the budget earlier. So this new budget's $237 billion, I believe, right? Which is a bit higher than what the governor even asked for. How did that happen?
So I've actually been in the assembly now. This is my sixth legislative session for the budget. And it's actually much worse than that. It's the number is actually higher. What was passed, it was like 240 plus billion because they keep adding stuff onto it. But what's bad about it is that it's actually gone up from when I first got there. It was about $170 billion. It's actually gone up at a astronomically high level. You know, we spend money in New York that we don't have on things that we don't need. And through a variety of circumstances, COVID being one of them, we are continuing to spend at a much higher level than we should possibly be able to spend at. And the money is taken directly from the taxpayers through a variety of taxes. If you want to talk tax policy, you know, I'm here to tell you that in New York, tax day may be April 15th, but tax freedom day is somewhere around the middle of May. That's when you actually start earning a dollar for yourself in New York on average. From January 1st to the middle of May, you're actually working to pay the government the tax money that you owe them in New York. And it's way too much. You can't believe the stuff that we spend money on.
I think I have this right. Doesn't New York State have a law that says the budget must be balanced, but it never is really balanced? Is that true?
So there is a requirement that when the budget is passed, that, you know, revenues must be the same as spending. But there's a lot of gimmickry that goes on, and this is where I object to the amount of debt that we carry in New York State. And that debt is held directly by the state, you know, $60-plus billion of debt. But there is debt that's held by I know this because I was in a public benefit corporation. A lot of authorities and public benefit corporations have an enormous amount of debt in New York State. It's called backdoor borrowing. So the MTA needs money. They'll go ahead and they have to borrow it. Well, instead of living within their means, within their revenue and their spending, they go ahead and they bond and they borrow money for these big projects. But on aggregate, it just adds to the cumulative tax burden for New York State, because these are public organizations that are borrowing money that has to be paid back, and it's guaranteed by the state. It's really egregious.
So take a project like DRI, a grant like DRI, which is terrific. Little Falls received $10 million a couple of years ago.
Right.
We haven't spent any of it yet, but we're getting there. Where does that money literally come from? Are they borrowing to give that to these communities?
No, so that's money that's out of the general fund, if you will. Mm-hmm. It's part of the budgeting process. And I like to tell people that it's actually resources returning to the communities. Mm-hmm. It shouldn't be that hard. They shouldn't simply not take the money out of the communities in the first place through a variety of state, federal, and local taxes that everyone pays. They should just leave the money in people's pockets, and then they would fund it much more naturally. People would fund their communities. I think it's not good that we, the state, takes money from people and then ask them to ask the state for it back in the form of a grant. That's the problem.
And compete for it.
Yeah. Some people have said it's akin to the Hunger Games, that movie, getting stuff back from the government sort of thing. But I would prefer that it would just be left to the lowest level of government to solve these problems.
So in this budget, there's $2.4 billion for aid to migrants, which includes public housing, mental health, housing, legal aid. What's your take on that?
So it shouldn't be happening at all. New York should not be a sanctuary state. They should close the southern border. The federal government should close the southern border and allow legal immigration to happen the way it's supposed to happen, according to federal law. There's nothing wrong with that from a policy perspective. You know, allowing people's first action coming into the United States to be to break the law is not a good precedent to set. I'm in favor of robust legal immigration. I'm in favor of making sure that when people come here, that they're welcomed into the community, that they have ties to the community, that they have jobs lined up, that they have the ability to support themselves and their family, and that they're welcomed into the American system on a path to citizenship that's certain and direct. There's nothing wrong with a policy like that. What we've got now is two sides that disagree fundamentally about what federal policy should be on immigration, and that has trickled down into state-level policies, New York City being a sanctuary city for one. The people in New York City want it to be a sanctuary city. The people in upstate New York should not have to pay for that policy. New York City has almost a $100 billion budget. If you want to offer services to illegal immigrants that are here contrary to federal law, then you should pay for them yourselves. It shouldn't be on a burden to take money from upstate communities, which need the money for transportation, we need it for education, we need it for the economic development of our area, and basically steal that money and give it to a group that is here violating federal law. There's nothing wrong with a policy that says that.
Do you get that opinion from constituents in your district? Why are we supporting New York City so much?
And that's because, yes, I do, and that's part of, you know, listening to what people, how they conceive government. And a lot of people in the district that I represent think that government is on the wrong track for supporting them. You know, I'll give you a for instance. For instance, the MTA, the Metropolitan Transportation authority. It runs the subway and bus system in New York. Very important role. They haven't had a fare increase on the subway system in over 10 years. Inflation has gone way up, but they keep the fares artificially low through an operating subsidy that all New Yorkers pay for. Meanwhile, the transportation aid to upstate communities for roads is less than $1 billion a year. Even though there are a comparable number of people in New York City versus the rest of the state, 5 to 1, money flows to the metro. Is that right? I don't think so.
Yeah, absolutely. How is New York State doing this budget without a tax increase?
So believe it or not, with inflation, the tax receipts are up for sales tax and for income tax. So as wages rise, the amount of tax revenue goes up. It's not a direct correlation, but it's pretty consistent. And with actually raising taxes as we have over the last 6 years, taxes have never gone down in New York in my time in the Assembly. So they'll say there's some minor taxes that they've reduced or they, you know, give somebody a tax credit for, but on aggregate, they've only gone up and they're only going to go up until people say no.
Yeah, we never get any money back unless it's a program like DRI. But doesn't New York State have a debt cap?
It does, and it can't be broken. There's a very specific fiscal plan that's analyzed each quarter. And then in terms of the budget, we, the minority, have to agree on the facts and figures that go into these numbers, this spreadsheet, if you will. And the debt cap itself cannot be broken. Just like in many communities, there's a, you know, the 2% tax cap, right? Okay. You can't raise budgets more than 2% in a year without a supermajority. Well, you have to raise taxes if you're going to, you know, break the debt cap. Yeah. We don't want taxes to rise in New York anymore. We're already either number one or two in aggregate tax burden in the entire country. New York's budget, $241 billion, is more than California's, which has twice as many people. And it's almost as much as Texas and Florida combined, which have way more than twice as many people. It's an eye-popping amount of spending that's driven primarily by the one out of three New Yorkers who's on state health insurance under the Medicaid program.
So how do we keep people in New York State? How do we keep them from fleeing to other places like Florida, other states where taxes are much lower?
So what's happening actually in upstate New York is rural out-migration. As the economy sours in upstate New York, people are literally picking up and leaving. And the worst demographic that's leaving are actually younger people with children. I had some facts and figures from Cornell has a population institute. And the out-migration in upstate New York is very high. It's like akin to what the Dust Bowl was in Oklahoma in the 1930s during the Depression. People are leaving in droves, and you see the numbers. They're being replaced, but in many cases, immigrants, and many of them are illegal immigrants in New York City. So some of the most, the people that are most involved in their communities, they have the means, are leaving, and they're unfortunately the ones that are coming in that keep the population relatively stable, don't have the same level, of means. They're new Americans is what the term is that the progressives use.
You're an environmental guy. There's $2.5 billion in this budget for environmental programs. Are you on board with all that?
So I actually did not vote in favor of this budget. And one of the things that's come up in the past is the Environmental Bond Act, which is borrowing money that we don't have, again, for programs that are that could be prioritized much more lower and keep taxes down for people. So, no, I'm not in favor of this Climate Leadership in the Community Protection Act, the Green New Deal, you know, the forced electrification of the upstate economy, you know, requiring schools to buy electric school buses that are the wrong, the wrong tool for the job in upstate communities. Reducing the amount of people that can get natural gas hookups, forcing people to buy heat pumps. None of that should happen. It should be based on technology and when the technology is ready, not forcing people to do so at an artificial point.
Anything in the budget that is good for our area, for your district?
So there are, one of the things that we did bring up to snuff was school aid. You know, for many, many years, our schools had been at a disadvantage because they hadn't fully funded the school aid formula. Unfortunately, now we're actually in the process of revising the foundation aid formula. We got it stable, and now because of all the things that have changed, the Rockefeller Institute is doing a study that we've participated in. We need to make sure that our rural schools get the money that they need to be able to keep them as the community pillars that they are, not some artificial one-size-fits-all formula, you know, based out of Albany. Because our schools are, they're very specific. There are a lot of smaller central school districts in the area that I represent, and we need to be innovative with technology. We need to be innovative with, you know, how we think about a school to be able to make sure that our kids are on a level playing field with the kids in the suburbs around New York City, or, you know, the ones that are in the New York City Department of Education in the city itself, mm-hmm. where there are plenty of students and plenty of, you know, schools. So you can offer every class that you want, sort of thing, if the kids are able to take it.
Is there anything else in this budget that you like?
Let me tell you about one thing I don't like. And the reason I say that is that sometimes priorities get misplaced. One of the things in the budget was swimming pools for floating swimming pools off of Manhattan in New York City, when I know I've got sewers that are collapsing in Dodgeville. It's really unfair that you can vote for something that's not necessary, not needed. Swimming pools are nice. If you want them in New York City, go ahead and vote your own New York City tax money for them. But don't take my money to do sewer and water infrastructure from upstate New York to do so. To me, that's just, it's just wrong. And it's just, you know, something that this imbalance in state government, you know, this one party rule really hurts us very deeply.
You have a tough job.
It's tough, but it's worthwhile. You know, I love being able to go out and talk to people and find out not only what they're thinking, but, you know, what they want from a public policy perspective. And that's what I've spent. That's why I've gotten on the Ways and Means Committee. You know, follow the money and you'll find the policy.
Yeah. So in your district, our district, particularly Mohawk Valley, Little Falls, Herkimer, Dallasville, Frankfort, Ilion. What are you hearing from people? If I had to ask you, what are the top three things that they complain about or ask you about? What would those be?
So 46 towns, 20 plus villages, three small cities, 4,000 square miles, 130,000 people. You know, the biggest thing I hear about is the imbalance between New York City and upstate regarding the values and voices in government, sort of thing. That I'm there to represent our voice and our values in Albany, and I do so effectively. But a lot of people feel the number one issue is that the people in those areas are not listening to that message, sort of thing. And I'm glad, because I want to be supported and be able to continue to take that message to Albany. But that's the number one thing, is they're not listening to us. And they do so at their own risk. You know, if New York City, it's about 300 square miles. If the people that live in New York City were suddenly on an island that was out in New York Harbor, you know, New York City would be about 11 million people. It would be a red state. It would be very much like Indiana, almost, if you will, where there would be, you know, cities that were run by Democrats, but there would be the vast majority of the people, 60% or more, would be similar to what the people in my district think about these variety of issues, because that's the weight that the city has when you put it in aggregate. You know, half the people live below an imaginary line in Westchester County, and half the people live above it. And it's demographics, you know, and they think differently about things. New York City is different.
So that's one issue. What else?
Let's see. Well, one that's been coming up is this Climate Leadership and the Community Protection Act. you know, people are feeling the pinch of having to change their systems based on, you know, technology that's immature. And it's coming, you know, whether it's a heat pump, you know, well, we're not going to do any more gas line hookups to, you know, to new construction. We're going to require zero emission buses for rural school districts where, you know, it's really cold and it's really, you know, really far to go up the hill sort of thing. The technology isn't ready. And now that it's come into their lives, people are like, what are we doing? You know, I voted no on this stuff 6 years ago, and it's, you know, it's finally here. And you see it in all of the renewable energy projects, you know, the resistance at the local level to those, you know, you see it in, you know, how people are starting to react to electric vehicles writ large. You know, they're not suited for our area. Maybe hybrids are, but electric vehicles aren't.
Yeah, the chefs out there, they like to cook on gas, so they having to cook on an electric stove is not going to be too popular.
Not in any of the restaurants that I eat in.
Yeah, exactly.
So,
I want to move over to bail reform. This has been something that's been talked about for quite a long time. I know the sheriffs around here, police departments, have complained bitterly about this. What's your stand on that?
So, what they did was they took some problems that they have in New York City, a place that's been run by Democrats for 50 years.
New York City again.
New York City. And then they flipped it. It was a Rikers Island Institute, mm-hmm. Rikers Island case where a kid was, you know, he shouldn't have been there. And, you know, it was a tragedy sort of thing. And then we turned the whole system of justice having to do with bail reform upside down in areas where it was working just fine. You know, I talked to district's attorney, I talked to judges, I talked to law enforcement, sheriffs, city police departments. There was nothing wrong with our system of bail that we had in this area. And this area wasn't untypical for the upstate region, if you will. And we just basically said, well, for this whole category of crimes, we're going to have them no longer be bail eligible, but with no judicial discretion. The judge who would actually know the people that come before them in our courts, unlike New York City, which is very impersonal, you never know what judge you're going to get sort of thing. These are people that have been elected by the people of our communities, town justices, city judges, county judges. They suddenly weren't able to decide these things. These were decided, you know, essentially by a commission that said, well, this is how, you know, the law is going to be written. And it's loosened up things, and it's really turned a lot of things on their head. At the same time, bail reform was also a lot of prison reforms, where, you know, I think it's very dangerous now for many of our corrections officers to be serving in these jails where there are very dangerous, mm-hmm. you know, criminals that are locked up. So there's been a lot of movement, and none of it's been in a good direction, and people are getting fed up with it because crime is up. And in fact, because it's so hard to charge someone with the crime, police agencies are actually not apprehending criminals as rapidly or making them, holding them as accountable as they had been in the past. So we've got lots of issues that they're really reaching a boiling point in many communities.
You sound like a law and order guy.
So fundamentally, it's important that if you have a law enforcement organization, you have to back them up from a civil perspective. If you're not, and again, in our area, you know, it's not an issue that where people of color have been disproportionately policed over decades, sort of thing. This is everybody's, you know, friends and neighbors who know everybody up here. It was misapplied. You know, the criminal justice reform, bail reform, prison reform, the shoe doesn't fit in upstate New York. Mm-hmm. But because we're one state, you know, wearing it is really pinching on people's feet.
So you were in the legislature when marijuana was legalized. What's your position on that, and how do you feel about the rollout?
Yeah, so the rollout has been an absolute disaster from start to finish, and it's because how the law was crafted, it was designed to write past social grievances. Basically, you had to be convicted of a past drug crime to be able to be head of the line for these dispensary applications to get it. So what's happened, and this has been a real tragedy, because we saw what was happening in Colorado. We didn't want to have the worst parts of the Colorado law, but we took them anyway. We've got three different problems going on. We've got marijuana that's being sold openly, but illegally in shops that are out there. We've got people that are now growing their own marijuana. You're allowed to have three plants, three mature and three immature plants. And then we've got the black market hasn't made a dent in it. And the supposed tax revenue that was going to come out of all this is, been non-existent, sort of thing. So the actual Office of Cannabis Management needs to be cleaned out, and we need to start over again with it. And we need to do some tweaks to the law, that will not make, I don't think we intended to have, marijuana, basically a civil liberties issue, become a health issue. And that's what we're in danger of doing, is people have been told for 40 plus years, don't smoke. And now we're going to have this really, unwieldy system. It's going to lead to some public health issues.
There's quite a bit of money in the new budget to shut down some of these illegal shops, right? Mostly in New York City. Again,
there were over 1,000 of them that just popped up. This is the entrepreneurial nature of New York City. They said, well, if we're not going to be policed, we're going to go ahead and sell this stuff, way before that they were actually allowed under these licenses that have been backlogged, and it's been a disaster.
Yeah. So what do you, as Assemblyman, what are you doing to support small business in our area?
Yeah, so that's actually one of the main thrusts of my legislative work, is to be able to get the small business, the idea that you can do business in New York, into the conversation, into the equation, sort of thing. And it's really hard to do so. Most of the small businesses in New York, about 50% of businesses in our area are small businesses that need help, not hindrance from state government. Whether it's a restaurant, they should be helped by the state health department to comply with the law. If it's a bar, they should be able to, okay, this is how you need to go to set up your liquor license so it's in accordance with the law. If you're running a construction firm and you have unemployment insurance issues, the labor department should be helping you. And unfortunately, what I find is that a lot of my constituent affairs work is me helping people. So if you're listening to this podcast and you need help with state government, you should call my office, because we've seen all of the issues, particularly with small businesses, particularly with the pandemic where they were shut down and then restarted. It's been quite a time to make sure that our small businesses are being able to be competitive, including those farms, which are almost all small businesses in New York. They have big issues that are coming in the coming years, having to do with the Farm Labor Wage Board, that are going to cost them significantly.
The minimum wage currently in New York is $15 an hour. Any feel for where that's going next year? I haven't seen anything published yet.
Well, if my progressive colleagues in the Democrat Socialists have their way, it's going to be somewhere north of $20 an hour. And it's simply unaffordable for upstate New York. I believe that we should have a very creative approach to this, that wages should be competitive. But perhaps we need to have like a training wage so we can have teenagers that want to learn how to work not have to meet this very artificially high threshold before they go to work for a small business in their hometown in upstate New York. It makes it very hard, and it distorts the labor market. The more you intervene in whatever the market is, the more it's going to get distorted. And that's the case, with the minimum wage as well. As people should be paid a fair amount for the work that they do, without a doubt. And I think that businesses ought to offer health insurance benefits so people don't have to be on public insurance. That would be a much better way to regulate our system, to help small businesses do that, as opposed to punishing them for, supposed violations of, of laws that don't really fit very well for upstate New York.
So you've been in office since 2019. You were elected in November of 2018. Looking back on your career in politics so far, what accomplishments are you most proud of?
Yeah, so actually, I'm very pleased to have helped during the pandemic. the people that were having trouble in the assembly district having to do with, for instance, unemployment insurance. The state shut down, people still had needs, and we actually delivered, you know, over 3,000 examples of casework mm-hmm. that helped people, you know, get through a very tough time sort of thing. The other thing I'm doing, and I'm still at it and working at it this term and next term, is rural equity, to make sure that in our rural areas of upstate New York, there's about 5 million people that live in bona fide rural areas. It's about 25% of our population, that they get their fair share from state government. And it's not just those in my district, it's across the entire state. You know, issues like broadband, issues like medical care in rural areas, issues like making sure that state government, as it evolves and it adapts to technology, that it actually works for the citizens in rural areas. I've really taken that one on, and I'm going to continue to do so. As long as I'm in the assembly, I'm going to make sure that our people in rural areas, you know, get a fair shake from their state government.
Earlier we talked about the legislative session, which ends in June.
Yep.
So what do you do after the session's done? What's that like?
Well, so that actually starts the... I spend, like I said, I had 46 towns, 20 plus villages, 3 small cities. I get around a lot to talk to a lot of people, mm-hmm. including going to a lot of local meetings. I spend time on this rural equity initiative, actually drafting the bills that are going to be part of the initiative. And I spend a lot of time making sure that I know not only what people are thinking in the district, but what people are thinking at the state level. And also at the national level. I belong to a couple national level organizations that think the same way about issues as the people in upstate New York do. So I do that work as well.
So despite what some people think, it's a 12-month a year job.
You know, I treat it as such. And the reason I treat it is that my wife and I, we've been very, very fortunate. I was able to retire from the Marine Corps. I give it all I got because it's worth it. And it's worth being the representative of the people all the time, not just part-time.
Well, you're running again, so you must enjoy it.
Well, it's good. Yeah, and there's a big big thing about outside employment. I don't have outside employment. So for me, it's about making sure that, like every other year you have to run. It's a two-year term. So every even-numbered election year from July to October, it's campaign season.
So there's a limitation on what you can earn from an outside job, correct?
That's correct.
Yeah.
And there's some issues with that. It's actually being challenged in court. I'm not sure where it's going to end up.
Yeah. Presidential election year. Any thoughts on the state of politics on the national level?
Boy, it's a doozy,
Isn't it though? Did you watch last night?
I did. I did watch thinking about the whole thing. We've never had a presidential election like this before. And I don't think we'll ever have one again.
Probably not.
It really matters. People really need to get out there and vote. That's what's really important.
Yeah.
Whatever you think, you really need to go out and act. And that's what I urge everybody to do.
I've had some friends of mine and some people in my family say that they may not vote this year. And I say, don't throw your vote away. It's a wonderful thing in our democracy to be able to vote, to actually vote.
It really is.
Don't throw it away.
It's what made us unique when we stood up the United States of America. It's what keeps us unique today. And your vote counts, and it counts at the national level, it counts at the state level, and it counts at the local level. And I urge everybody to get out there and vote and make sure that they urge their family and friends to do so as well.
Robert, I've really enjoyed this. It's wide-ranging. I think we covered a lot of ground. I appreciate you coming in. I know you're busy in your travels around the district and in Albany. So thank you very much, and good luck in November.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be on here, and thanks for letting me connect with your listeners.
Oh, you're very welcome. And that's it for me this time. Next up is Sylvia Rowan, who was a delegate to the Republican National Convention. And also behind her, I'm going to have Jim Walczak, a veteran of the Vietnam War, who's going to tell his story. Really looking forward to that one. Thank you very much. Hope to see you again.